organizer of this conference, and I'm really honored and pleased to open it. And the first thing that I want to do is to thank Dr. Peter Goddard, the director of the Institute for Advanced Study, for hosting this event in recognition of Michael Walzer's work. We are very happy and thankful that it is being held here at the Institute. Michael has been a permanent faculty in the Institute for more than three decades. Am I right, Michael? Almost three decades, okay. And the IES is a home to other incredible permanent faculty. And they host visiting social scientists, historians, mathematicians, and natural scientists to help advance their individual pursuit of pure research in a singular environment. The director was involved in making this conference possible in crucial ways, and I'm personally thankful to him for his collaboration. It is my pleasure to introduce Peter Goddard.
Well, it's my great pleasure to welcome you on behalf of the Institute to this conference in celebration of Michael Walzer and his work. And I must begin by thanking Yitzhak Benbaji for all the hard work he's done to organize this conference so very effectively. The conference is being supported by a number of organizations, the Fritz Thyssen Stiftung, the Shalom Hartman Institute, the YIVO Institute for Jewish Research, the Bar-Ilan University Faculty of Law, the Heinrich Boll Foundation. We're grateful to them all, but we most especially we would like to thank the Carnegie Council for Ethics and International Affairs, without whose support this conference would not be taking place. Michael Walzer joined the faculty of the Institute's then very young School of Social Science in 1980, moving from Harvard University, where he had been professor of government since 1966, and where he had earlier obtained his doctorate in 1961. Michael became UPS Foundation Professor here in 1986, and Emeritus Professor in 2007. He's been succeeded as UPS Professor by Daniel Allen, whom I know is desperately disappointed not to be able to be with us today. With the late Clifford Geertz, whom we all so sorely miss, Emeritus Professor Albert Hirschman, Joan Scott, and more recently Eric Maskin, Michael has formed our School of Social Science. Speaking calmly, fearlessly, and with great clarity, Michael retains his position as one of this country's foremost political thinkers, continuing to address a wide range of topics in political theory and moral philosophy, from the concepts of just and unjust war through nationalism and ethnicity to economic justice and the welfare state. Although retired, mainly in the very limited sense of not getting paid anymore by the Institute, Michael remains a very vital part of our academic community, held in the greatest of affection and respect as he continues his major collaborative work on the history of Jewish political thought, his work as contributing editor of Dissent, which he's been doing for more than 30 years, and very much else besides. It gives us all at the Institute the very greatest of pleasure to be able to act as hosts for this conference on justice, culture, and tradition, and to see Michael's towering contributions to ethical and political philosophy recognized in this way.
Thank you very much, Peter. Well, I thought to make a kind of overview of the sessions, but we're beyond schedule, so let me just thank the many institutions and people that were involved in preparing this conference. Let me say that the enthusiasm that these institutions and people expressed in helping us making this conference possible is just a symptom of the width and depth of the influence of Michael's work. The director talked about the institution, and as I told you, I want to name some of the people. And first and foremost, I'd like to thank Michael and Judy Walzer. Judy liked the idea of making the conference at the very beginning, while Michael was mainly embarrassed by it. Fortunately, he did not reject the idea. And as time passed, Michael got used to the fact that the conference is going to take place, and join Judy in making very helpful suggestions and remarks. I'm thankful to Michael and to Judy for their help and friendship. The assistance of John Scott, Michael's colleague in the School of Social Sciences, her guidance, advice, and support were crucial. Thanks to Amy Gutmann and to my teacher, Avishai Margalit, who were very happy to join the academic committee. Avishai and I were here in the Institute when I started thinking about the conference, and his advices were as wise as always. At various stages, the collaboration with Mike Gehrt and Kamala Brash of the Institute for Advanced Study was absolutely crucial. My dean, Yaffa Zilberschatz, is she here? No. My dean, Yaffa Zilberschatz of the law faculty at Bar-Ilan University, offered her help and support somewhat like 10 seconds after she heard about the idea of making a conference for Michael. And the response of Rabbi Daniel Hartman, the director of the Shalom Hartman Institute, was very similar. So I'm really thankful to them for their trust. I remember the moment I started to believe that this conference is going to happen. I got a supportive phone call from Joel Rosenthal, the president of the Carnegie Council for Ethics in International Affairs. When I met with Joel and his staff, I started to believe that the conference is going to be well organized, despite the fact that its organizer lives and teaches too much, I should say, in Israel. And he himself, the organizer, namely, is not very well organized. The support we got from Joel, Eva Becker, Marina, and others from the council was truly priceless. As the participants well know, Danielle Candy from the council is the conference coordinator. Her dedication to the conference, her professionalism, perfectionism, and kindness, and her skills and abilities made the organization of this conference a much less stressing experience. Having her in our side in the next few days is absolutely crucial, Danielle. Now let us get down to business. John Scott is going to chair the first session.
Well, before we start, actually, there's one more big thank you. When Yitzhak came to me in the fall of 2006 with an idea for this conference, which he says he proposed in his application for membership, and which those of us reviewed it don't remember his having proposed, we repressed it. We talked for a while about what running a conference would involve, and it was clear he had no idea of what running a conference would involve. I said to him, you know, you're going to have to raise a lot of money, and he was surprised. I said, you know, coordination is really a difficult thing, and getting all these people and doing all of this stuff, and he was surprised. And to his enormous credit, he learned how to do this. And he did it with a kind of energy and enthusiasm, despite frowns and questions from many of us. He persisted. He raised the money. He got the people he wanted to come. He organized it. And I was walking over here this morning, I thought, if anybody needs to organize a conference in the future, the person to go to now is the expert on conference organization, Yitzhak Benbaji. I think we owe him a huge round of applause. Now we get down to work. I kept thinking as I came over here that what I should say to this audience and with this group of presenters, that they need no introduction at all and we could just go on with it, but you can't ever really do that. So I'm going to introduce them all in order and then they can each take the platform as they are listed on your program. Thomas Scanlon is the Alfred Professor of Natural Religion, Moral Philosophy, and Civil Polity at Harvard. He received his BA from Princeton in 1962 and then a PhD from Harvard. His main work has been in moral and political philosophy. He's published papers on freedom of expression, the nature of rights, conceptions of welfare, theories of justice, and meta-ethics. He's the author of What We Owe to Each Other and The Difficulty of Tolerance. Michael Sandel is currently Ann T. and Robert M. Bass Professor of Government at Harvard. He is a contemporary political philosopher, the author of Liberalism and the Limits of Justice, Democracy's Discontent, America in Search of a Public Philosophy, Public Philosophy, Essays on Morality in Politics, and the case, most recently, The Case Against Perfection, Ethics in the Age of Genetic Engineering. Amy Gutmann, one of the early students of Michael Walzer, has been president of the University of Pennsylvania since 2004. Before going to Penn, she served as provost at Princeton, where she was also the Lawrence S. Rockefeller University Professor of Politics. She was the founding director of the University Center for Human Values, and because of her wonderful contacts with Michael, it was not a competitive institution for the School of Social Science, but a complementary one. It's a multidisciplinary center that sponsors teaching, scholarship, and public discussion of ethics and human values. She's authored and edited many books, published dozens of articles, essays, and book chapters, most recently, Why Deliberative Democracy in 2004 with Dennis Thompson, Identity in Democracy, Democratic Education, Democracy and Disagreement. It's my great pleasure to welcome all three of these presenters to this first session this morning, and we'll start with Thomas Scanlon.
Is this a microphone live?
Yes.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be able to participate in this tribute to Michael, from whom I've learned an enormous amount over the years. I've been assigned the role of talking about distributive justice, so I'll concentrate today on Spheres of Justice, a remarkable book among many, many remarkable books by Michael, and a book that I've taught at least every other year since it first came out. Every time I return to it, I find more in it that I agree with and am persuaded and impressed by. I want to begin by distinguishing three themes in that book. The first theme, complex equality, holds that different standards of distribution are appropriate for different goods. These standards do not always require equal distribution of those goods. The standards appropriate to the distribution of educational resources, for example, may require different individuals to be treated differently and to receive different kinds of education depending on their differing needs and talents. These inequalities in the distribution of a good are not even prima facie objectionable. They are, you might say, the right form of equality. And they don't need to be balanced by compensating inequalities in other goods. This is in contrast to what Michael calls a doctrine of simple equality, which he says would require equality in overall welfare, for example, or in some basket of primary social goods, with greater gains in one good balanced somehow by lesser quantities of another. According to complex equality, an unequal distribution of given good is unjust if it's not in accordance with the standards appropriate to that good, or, a second important case, if this inequity brings with it a distribution of some other good that is not in accord with the standards for those goods. So, for example, a distribution of educational opportunities would be unjust on this latter ground if it led to an objectionable inequality of income or objectionable inequality in political power. The second theme of the book, which I'll call the meaning dependence of distributive standards, holds that the standard of just distribution for a good is determined by the meaning of that good. Now, at least part of what this means is that the criteria of just distribution for a good are determined by what it is that makes that good a good. That's what seems to me to be central to the idea of meaning. For example, to identify the proper criteria for the distribution of educational resources, we should consider what it is that makes education something that people should want to have and that the society should want to provide. These would include such things as self-development, economic opportunity, participation in civic life, and so on. The distribution of education should then, according to this view, be determined by what different individuals need and can use to achieve these things. This may require, as I said, giving different kinds and amounts of education to different individuals. The third theme is what I'll call the social dependence of meanings. This holds that the meaning of a good, in the sense that determines its just distribution in society, is the meaning it has within the culture of that society. Meaning in this sense can vary from society to society, and it follows from the themes previously mentioned that when the meaning of a good varies in this way, the standards of just distribution for that good vary with it. This relativist strand in the theory attracted much attention and criticism when Spheres of Justice first appeared. But it seems very plausible in some cases. The kind of education that's needed for intellectual self-development, for example, may vary from one society to another, depending on the larger intellectual life of that society. In some cases, the kind of intellectual activity that is available may require one to be proficient in Latin, in which case education in Latin has a degree of importance that it would not have in some other society in which Latin was an arcane interest. Similarly, societies which vary in whether fluency in Latin is or is not necessary to participate in public life will give rise to different reasons for having that kind of education. In a society in which Latin is not so important, there might be no objection to having education in Latin be available only to the children of the rich. But this would be objectionable if all public political debates were conducted in Latin, since this distribution of educational opportunity would bring with it an inequality in political power. This much seems very plausible, even uncontroversial. But according to a strict reading of the social dependence of meanings, an unequal distribution of political power will be in itself unjust only if it is contrary to the meaning that political power has in the society in question. If, for example, political power is seen as the prerogative of a certain class, then a distribution of political power only to that class would not be unjust, and there would be no objection of the kind I just mentioned to a distribution of educational opportunity, according to which only children of the members of that class had the opportunity to learn Latin, or whatever the language is in which politics is carried out. An essential feature of demands for equality is their comparative character. Not every view takes individuals to be morally equal. Sorry, let me just interpose here. I've distinguished three themes. I'm going to concentrate on the first two themes and not so much on the second, that is the third, that is the relativistic strain with which I disagree a little bit. So I will raise a few questions about that, but I want to concentrate on the virtues of the first two ideas. An essential feature of demands for equality is their comparative character. Not every view that takes individuals to be morally equal is comparative in this way. And so not every view is egalitarian in the sense that I have in mind. According to Robert Nozick's view in Anarchy, State, and Utopia, for example, individuals are morally equal in that they have the same rights. But these rights are non-comparative. In order to know whether someone's rights are being violated, it is enough to know what has been done to him or her. It's not necessary to know how others have been treated. A demand for equality, on the other hand, is a demand to be treated in the same way as others are treated, to have the same income as they do, for example, or the same level of some social service. Such a demand can, in principle, be met by giving them less as well as by giving you more. And this is what gives rise to the suspicion that demands for equality, as opposed to demands simply to be made better off in some material respect, are expressions of envy. If my demand can be satisfied by you having less, why should that be a reasonable demand? As Michael observes in the introduction to Spheres of Justice, one of the main tasks of an egalitarian theory of justice is to answer this charge that claims to equality are merely expressions of envy. I myself am drawn to a pluralistic conception of equality, according to which there are many independent reasons for objecting to inequality rather than a single overarching demand for equality, in large part because of its ability to provide this kind of answer to the charge of envy. What I want to do now is to consider some of these answers and to see how they correspond to the answers that are provided by a doctrine of complex equality of the kind that Michael sets out in Spheres of Justice. To see the advantage of a pluralistic account over some forms of simple equality, consider an abstract description of two societies. Here I'm taking up an example discussed by Larry Temkin in his book on inequality. Suppose that in both of these societies, the great majority of citizens enjoy the same level of welfare, which we can assume is a really very nice, comfortable level. In one society, however, call it Peakville, there are, in addition to these people at a very nice level, a very few people who are much, much better off living in the lap of luxury. In the other society, Valleyland, in addition to the same group of most people living at a very tolerable level, there's a smaller group of the same size as the rich people in the first society who are much, much worse off than the majority. Let's suppose that they aren't living in situation of misery. Their situation is comfortable, but it's considerably worse than that of the majority. Temkin asks, which of these societies is worse than the other from the point of view of equality, or whether, judged from the point of view of equality, they are the same. In one sense, they are the same. They have the same Gini coefficient, for example. Considered in the abstract, a preference between Peakville and Valleyland then might seem to be an arbitrary preference for one pattern of distribution over another pattern. But in order to properly assess objections to these societies from the point of view of equality, we need to look more specifically at the goods involved. For example, one obvious objection to Valleyland, the society with a small number of relatively poor citizens, is that these citizens are likely to live in a way that, in comparison to the norm in their society, they reasonably find shameful or humiliating. As Adam Smith observed, there is a serious objection to a society in which some people are so much poorer than others that they have to live and dress in such a way that they can't go out in public without shame. In Michael's version of complex equality, this objection might be put by saying that in such a society, one sphere, that is, the sphere of income and wealth, is unacceptably allowed to dominate another sphere, the sphere of honor or recognition. It's certainly true that the evil in question here has a socially relative dimension and depends upon the meaning in the society in question of, let's say, dressing in a certain way or living in a certain way or being able to do certain things. What is reasonably found humiliating in one society need not be the same as what is reasonably found humiliating in another. But the idea that being forced to live in a way that, under the circumstances, it would be reasonable to find humiliating does not itself seem a socially relative matter. Whatever the best way of putting this point may be, however, the objection to a society, or this kind of objection to a society like Valleyland, seems to be a sound one, and it seems to rest on a particular kind of objection to inequality. This objection doesn't apply to Peakville, in which most people are quite well off, but there's a small group of extraordinarily rich folks. But in order to assess Peakville, we need to know more than this abstract description tells us. If the very wealthy consist of a few movie stars or athletes whose relative wealth derives from the eagerness of their fans to see them perform, this wealth may be, I would say, unobjectionable from the point of view of equality. That is, it may not in itself give rise to any claim of injustice. It might be a case in which money is, as Michael says, harmless, because it doesn't, having money doesn't carry with it other goods that it shouldn't bring. But things are quite different if the small number of well-to-do people are the people who own the factories at which all the others must work if they want to earn a living. In this case, the well-off have an unacceptable degree of control over the lives of others, over their working lives, and probably also over what gets produced and what's available for consumption and enjoyment. In the language of spheres of justice, this might be seen as a case in which one sphere of distribution inappropriately dominates another, a case in which the good of wealth tyrannizes over the good of power or liberty. Again, one can debate whether this is the best way of putting the matter. A natural alternative, what I would say, would be to say that the objection to these arrangements doesn't derive from the particular social meaning of a good of liberty or the good of power in that particular society, but rather from the fact that, whatever the social meanings of goods in one society may be, people have good reason to want not to have their lives controlled in this way. But whichever way the objection is put, it shows, I think, the advantage of a pluralistic conception to tell the difference between Peakville and Valleyland, to decide which one of them is more objectionable on grounds of equality. You have to look at what's involved and what the goods are and what reason people have for objecting to the distribution of those goods. Another way in which inequalities can be objectionable is by undermining the fairness of basic social institutions. Here are two familiar examples. When there is great inequality in family income and wealth, individuals' prospects of success in a competitive market are greatly affected by the families into which they are born. This makes it difficult, if not impossible, to achieve equality of economic opportunity. Second, on the political side, great inequalities in wealth and income undermine the fairness of political institutions. The wealthy will be much more able than others to gain political office themselves, much more able to influence those who hold office, who must be dependent on them for contributions, and much more able to influence the course of political debate and legislation. These are familiar facts. The requirements of economic and political fairness that I've been considering here, though, come in both formal and substantive varieties. Formally speaking, political fairness requires that all citizens have the same political rights, equal rights to vote, rights to speak, to run for office, and so on. But substantively, there's a further question of what people are able to do with these rights, how effectively they can use them to gain political office or influence the course of political events. Similarly, in the economic case, formal equality of economic opportunity is achieved when everyone has the same rights to participate in the market, same right to qualify and compete for jobs. And if candidates for positions to which special rewards are attached are judged on their qualifications for those jobs without discrimination, nepotism, and so on, then this form of formal equality is achieved. Substantive equality of economic opportunity, on the other hand, goes beyond this and requires that individuals who have the underlying talent have a proper chance to develop their talent into actual qualifications for positions of economic advantage. Fair equality of opportunity in this sense, as Rawls famously put it, requires that, these are Rawls's words, those who are at the same level of talent and ability and have the same willingness to use them should have the same prospects of success regardless of their initial place in the social system. Now, when I said above that economic inequality can be objectionable because it conflicts with the fairness of economic and political institutions, the conflict I had in mind was with the substantive versions of these ideas of political and economic fairness. Given that these substantive requirements are extremely difficult to satisfy, very difficult as we know to achieve either kind of substantive equality in a society marked by income differences, given that these requirements are difficult to satisfy, it's worth asking why they are required. What is the case for not only formal equality of opportunity in political and economic life, but beyond that, substantive equality of opportunity as well? Despite, or perhaps because of, the nearly universal lip service paid to these requirements, especially to the idea of equal economic opportunity, on the right, I think, is least as much as on the left, there is little discussion of this question of justification. So I want to consider briefly what kind of justification might be offered, and in particular, whether a social meaning account may have something distinctive to contribute in this regard. In the political case, the justification for substantive equality is relatively straightforward. If a political process is to issue in laws that all citizens are obligated to obey, then they need to have a role in shaping these laws. And this role is not guaranteed simply by formal equality. It requires also a meaningful opportunity to use formal rights to participate in the political process. As I indicated above, this justification can naturally be stated in terms of the social meaning of power. In the economic case, on the other hand, the justification for equality of opportunity is not as immediate and seems to me to be an interestingly open and difficult question. Consider first the justification for formal equality of economic opportunity, which requires that everyone be legally entitled to participate in the economy and that candidates for jobs should be considered on the basis of their job-related qualifications. This is the form of equality of opportunity that Michael discusses most fully in Spheres of Justice. Here we can argue that if the justification for having a position to which special privileges or special rewards are attached is based on the advantages that this specialization brings to the institutions in question or to the economy as a whole, then a hiring officer who hires some people, who hands out these positions on some basis other than job-related qualifications, is misusing his or her authority. This rules out not only such things as racial discrimination, but also nepotism, and also simply failing to study the qualifications of the applicants because it would be too much work to read their dossiers. In each case, the hiring officer would be failing to act in a way that is justified by the justification for having the positions that he or she is handing out. This is, so far, a top-down justification for equal treatment. That is, it derives ultimately from the needs for and justification for the institutional arrangements in question, including the positions of unequal ward that these institutions involve. Claims of individual applicants to equal consideration are, so far as anything I've said, derivative from this top-down justification. In the case of racial discrimination, there may be a further claim that individuals have, let's say, a claim not to be excluded or not to be rejected. But this can be explained on some other basis, such as the one I described above in discussing objections to inequalities of status. Now, the top-down justification for formal equality that I've just given fits well with Michael's doctrine of complex equality, since it could be put by saying that it is part of the social meaning of certain positions that they should be given to people with certain qualifications. And indeed, what I've said here tracks fairly closely what Michael says in Spheres of Justice, in particular his remark that equality of opportunity applies to careers that have been turned into offices, like the Pope and so on, other offices that ought to go to people with particular distinction. Now, the question is how this justification for formal equality of opportunity in either of the two versions I've described, that is the social meaning version or my version independent of that, can be extended to cover the case of substantive equality of opportunity as well. How can we get from a justification for formal equality of economic opportunity to a requirement, to the much more robust requirement of fair equality of opportunity that Rawls states? This is a question because these substantive requirements are very difficult and very costly to fulfill. Insofar as the top-down argument for formal equality of opportunity that I sketched appeals at its base to what's needed in order to make certain institutions function well, it may seem to lead to, at best, a qualified case for substantive equality of opportunity. Achieving fair equality of opportunity could improve the functioning of these institutions by increasing the size and perhaps the quality of the pool of qualified applicants. If we improve education so that talented poor children are just as able to develop the talents to apply for these jobs as talented children of rich families, we increase the pool, thereby maybe making the institutions function more effectively because their offices are fulfilled by better people. But if the guiding aim is simply the aim of improving institutional functioning, there's always a question of how much this degree of improvement in efficiency is worth. The point at which the gains might fail to offset the cost of further investment in education, further support to families, and so on, might be reached well before anything like fair equality of opportunity is achieved. We may not need to dip that far into the pool in order to fill the jobs with the talented people we need. So we have only, on this top-down view, only a qualified defense of fair equality of opportunity. Within the view advanced in Spheres of Justice, we might bridge the gap between formal equality and substantive equality if we could argue that the social meaning of the offices in question not only requires that these offices be assigned to the candidates who present themselves with the best qualifications, but also that they should go to the members of the society who have the best underlying talent for such positions. Maybe this is the way the search for the Dalai Lama is carried. They go out and search all the infants and try to find, it's not just the ones who presented themselves as candidates have to be selected among, but you want to get the people who have the best underlying talent. This would be parallel to the argument for substantive equality in the political case. I'm not sure how plausible it is to claim this as a claim about social meanings. An alternative argument that seems to be more plausible would be based not on the meaning of the offices in question, but on the forms of education required to develop qualifications for these offices. The idea would be that where offices of a certain kind exist, the forms of education required to develop a qualification for these offices is a good whose meaning is that it should be distributed on the basis of native talent rather than, say, by the market. Of course, taking seriously the social dependence of meanings, that was the third theme in Michael's book, there's the problem that the good of education may not have this meaning in a given society. As I say, in a given society, education might have the meaning of serving only the interests of one class. So this argument for substantive equality of opportunity would again be conditional. Stepping outside Michael's framework, we might develop a parallel argument appealing to what I call the principle of equal benefit. This is the principle that if the state is obligated to everyone to provide a certain benefit, then it's an objection if it provides that benefit at a higher level to some groups in society than it does to others. So applying that principle, we could say, where positions exist that require special qualification and bring special benefit, including monetary benefit, but also the non-monetary benefit of interesting work and of exercising one's developed talent, where such positions exist, where those opportunities exist in society, the state has an obligation to provide everyone with the kind of education necessary to develop these qualifications for these jobs. That's a good exercising those talents is a good that people can enjoy in that society, and so there's an obligation to provide the education that opens that good to people. If there is this obligation, then, according to the principle of equal benefit, it must be made available equally to all those who have the requisite talent, regardless of their social class, and so on. Now, some further argument would be needed for the claim that this particular good is one that the state is obligated to provide. I've just stipulated that. But still, a two-stage argument of this kind seems to me at present a plausible way of stating the case of substantive economic opportunity. I call it a two-stage argument because it doesn't claim that substantive equality of opportunity is a condition on the justness of the offices in question, as Rawls's argument would seem to do. Rather, what the existence of those jobs does is create the possibility for people in having enjoyable lives of a certain kind. That brings with it the need for education to make people able to enjoy those goods if they can, and then the principle of equal benefit requires that that education be given to anybody who has the talent for it. In closing, I want to consider what the accounts of equality that I've been discussing have to say about a widely discussed contemporary question, which is the increasing economic inequality in contemporary American society. As Paul Krugman has written, over the past 30 years, most people have seen only modest salary increases. The average salary in America, expressed in 1998 dollars, that is, adjusted for inflation, rose from $32,522 in 1970 to $35,864 in 1999. That's about a 10% increase over 29 years. Progress, but not much. Over the same period, however, according to Fortune magazine, the average real annual compensation of the top 100 CEOs went from $1.3 million, which was 39 times the pay of an average worker at the time, to $37.5 million, more than 1,000 times the pay of ordinary workers. Since Krugman wrote these words 5 years ago, the phenomenon he was describing has grown more extreme. And it seems widely agreed, as Krugman's tone implies, that there's something objectionable about this increasing inequality. It seems to be widely thought not only to be objectionable, but to be objectionable because of the inequality involved, not merely because of, say, the immiseration of the people at the bottom, but because of the increasing gap between the people at the bottom and the people at the top. The objection seems to be a comparative one, and the question I want to address at the end is, what do the views of equality we've been considering have to say about why this difference is in itself something we should worry about? Even if the class of super-rich people may live in a society very different from the rest of us, this doesn't, I think, give us grounds for feeling humiliated or inferior or ashamed of our more modest ways of life. So inequality of status doesn't seem to be an issue in this case. We might say instead that this level of inequality is objectionable because it will, at least over time, undermine equality of opportunity, and also because it gives these people unacceptable political power in the form of ability to buy influence by giving large contributions to political candidates and parties. I think these things may well be true, but I doubt that they support the thought that there's something particularly objectionable about recent increases in inequality resulting from higher levels of executive compensation, hedge fund managers, and so on. Equality of opportunity was already seriously undermined by the much smaller differences in income and wealth that existed at the beginning of the period Krugman describes. And increases of the incomes of the rich since that time don't seem to make that situation worse, at least on the economic opportunity side. There's a limit to the amount of money you can spend to give your children a leg up, even given high tuitions. Worries that these increases in inequality undermine political fairness may be more germane. But again, that doesn't seem to be anything new. It's a change of degree, which is, I might say, moderate. There seems to be something more independent of this that people are objecting to. One possible response would be to say that insofar as even extreme inequalities don't give rise to the problems I listed, problems of status, problems of domination, or harms to the fairness of political and economic institutions, there is no further objection to them purely on grounds of inequality. When they don't have these costs, it might be said, inequalities in income and wealth have been rendered, as Michael says, harmless. The spheres are separate in their proper ways. Now, I don't think that's true, because I think these inequalities in wealth do bring some problems of that kind, but I don't think that doesn't seem to fully capture what's wrong. This may be the view that people take of inequality created by the wealth of entertainment and sports figures, I think. But people seem to find, and I think there is, something more objectionable in the case of the wealth of corporate executives and others. One possible ground for this might be the thought that these executives are gaining something they're not entitled to at the expense of the workers in their firms. The underlying idea might then be something like the assumption that seems to underlie the benchmark of equality in Rawls's theory, that free and equal participants in a cooperative enterprise have a prima facie claim to share equally in the goods that their cooperation produces. This may be part of it, but I don't know that we have similar feelings about the relation between the income of film stars and that of the grips and best boys who are listed in the credits at the end of the film, not to mention the truck drivers and so on who are not even listed. Perhaps we should have such feelings, but there seems to be something distinctive about the sense of resentment at the income of these business executives. One explanation of what's distinctive might be that the objection to the pay of corporate executives is not an objection to inequality. It's rather an objection to the process that yields it. Film stars and sports figures, we might say, are at least earning their pay in what appears to be a genuinely competitive market. The compensation packages of executives, on the other hand, are set by compensation committees composed, we often imagine, of other CEOs who are their friends and golfing companions, or at least are driven by the same shared idea of what people like them ought to be paid, rather than being driven and controlled by pure market factors. As Michael says, the gross inequalities that we see around us of this kind may, and these are Michael's words, derive more significantly from status hierarchies, organizational structures, and power relations than from the free market. This seems to me an important part of the problem. But whether, in addition, there is some further objection to these inequalities, qua inequalities, beyond the objections I've so far identified, and therefore a further element, a further demand for equality beyond the pluralistic list I have given, is a question that I don't know the answer to, but which I hope will be answered in the discussion. Thank you very much.
Michael Sandel.
Of the many reasons to celebrate Michael Walzer's career, I would like to celebrate his role as a dissenting voice among his people. And by his people, I mean American liberals and social democrats. At a time when leading theories of justice sought principles that abstracted from actual persons and the goods they prize, Michael argued that justice was not to be found in such abstractions. Hypothetical social contracts to the contrary, he argued, distributive justice must attend to the meaning of the goods whose distribution is at stake and to the role those goods play in the life of the political community. Arguments about justice, Michael teaches us, and I would say rightly, arguments about justice are inseparable from arguments about the meaning of goods. It's sometimes argued that tying justice to the meaning of goods is objectionable because it makes justice the creature of convention and so deprives justice of its critical character. If principles of justice simply reflect the shared understanding of goods in a particular society, the argument goes, then it's unclear how those principles can ever criticize existing arrangements. This was the objection that Tim referred to as the relativist objection. I don't believe that Michael's account of justice requires this kind of relativism. The idea that justice is tied to the meaning of goods leads to relativism only on the further assumption that it's not possible to reason about goods. But my purpose in this paper isn't to take up that question directly, but to highlight two attractive features of Michael's account of justice, features that offer certain moral and political advantages or so it seems to me, over the familiar liberal account. The first advantage is that Michael's way of thinking about distributive justice pays greater attention to the social solidarity that any scheme of public provision requires. On his view, solidarity is internally connected to justice. It's not a contingent fact about certain societies that makes it easier to implement principles of justice independently defined. Consider two ways of justifying the public provision of goods characteristic of most welfare states: healthcare, education, welfare, security, and so on. One way seeks to derive these goods from a hypothetical social contract or from principles of fairness. A second way, the way of spheres of justice, argues differently. It says that goods like healthcare, education, and so on should not be distributed according to wealth, but according to principles appropriate to the kind of goods they are and to the role they play in the life of the community. On this view, Michael's view, which goods should be publicly provided, and equally important, how they should be provided, depends on what might be called formative considerations. The case for public provision depends as much on cultivating social solidarity as on enacting abstract notions of fairness. Michael puts it this way: political community for the sake of provision, provision for the sake of community. The process works both ways, and that, he writes, is perhaps its crucial feature. To take an example, the argument for the common school in 19th century America took this form. The case for public education was not only to provide fair equality of opportunity, it was also to cultivate a common citizenship, to integrate immigrant children into the life of the nation, to deepen the bonds of political community. If political education were justified only or mainly on grounds of fairness, one could imagine a sufficiently generous system of vouchers redeemable at private schools that would satisfy that right. But even if such a system gave everyone access to a decent education, even if it answered the requirements of fairness, it might still be objectionable for failing to form the civic habits and sense of belonging necessary to sustain a robust common life, including the commitment to educate all members of the community. So here, it seems to me, is one distinctive advantage of Michael's way of thinking about distributive justice. He insists that part of what justifies public education, national health care, public police protection, and so on, part of what justifies these provisions is that providing these goods collectively builds the kind of community that can sustain the provision. Here's how he puts it: quote, mutual provision breeds mutuality. So the common life is simultaneously the prerequisite of provision and one of its products. This is what I mean by the internal connection between distributive justice and social solidarity. Now, contractarians may acknowledge that societies with high levels of social solidarity are more likely to provide the public goods that justice requires. But how that solidarity comes about is, for them, a contingent question of political sociology or of moral psychology, unrelated to the philosophical question of what the right principles of justice are. And this makes a political difference, it's not only a philosophical debate. Liberals often wonder, with perplexity and dismay, why their arguments about fairness find so little political resonance, especially at a time when inequality in the United States has reached staggering proportions. Why don't fairness arguments carry more political weight? The standard explanation is that voters are too selfish to raise taxes to help the disadvantaged, or too distracted by cultural issues to see that a more generous welfare state would really be in their interest too. But the political ineffectiveness of liberal invocations of fairness may also reflect the mistaken attempt to detach arguments about justice from arguments about the meaning of goods and from the project of forming citizens who share a common life. So, by showing us how distributive justice and social solidarity are internally connected or reciprocally dependent, Michael offers the corrective to liberal theories that put fairness first. That seems to me one powerful advantage of Michael's view. A second is that his approach focuses more directly than do standard liberal theories on the need to keep markets in their place. Michael wrote in Spheres of Justice of blocked exchanges. He provided, he even said boldly, an exhaustive list. In the years since Michael wrote, those blocked exchanges have become more porous and permissive. No sphere is now immune from market practices and market logic. Take education. Recent decades have seen the advent of for-profit schools, of commercial advertising in public schools, of financial rewards to teachers whose students score well on standardized tests, cash payments to the students themselves for high test scores or for reading a certain number of books. Take healthcare. We now have for-profit hospitals. We have doctors who offer what's quaintly called concierge care to a small number of patients who pay thousands of dollars a year for privileges such as same-day appointments and the physician's cell phone number. We have MRIs and CAT scans in shopping malls, marketed without prescription or medical need to the anxious affluent. We have direct-to-consumer advertising of prescription drugs that market the disease, restless leg syndrome, erectile dysfunction, even shyness, that market the disease as much as the cure. Take law enforcement and criminal justice. In the United States, spending on private security services is now more than twice the amount spent on public law enforcement. More Americans work as private security officers than as public police officers. The private prison industry has become a billion-dollar business. One of these companies, the Corrections Corporation of America, runs more prisons than all but three states in the federal government. Take national security. The outsourcing of war to private military contractors is a growing trend. In fact, the second largest contingent of security personnel in Iraq after the US military troops was provided not by Britain, but by private military companies like Blackwater. 3/4 of the US intelligence budget now goes not to CIA spooks, but to hired spies and private contractors. And finally, the human body. We have for-profit fertility clinics and sperm banks that market premium eggs and sperm from paid donors with desirable genetic profiles. Bio-entrepreneurs scramble to patent genes and other life forms. Economists advise countries seeking to reduce their populations to issue procreation permits that can be bought and sold. People are even willing to turn their bodies into billboards. I read a news account of a little taqueria in San Francisco that offered a free lunch for life to anyone willing to tattoo the restaurant's logo to his or her body. So many people showed up with the tattoo that this little restaurant is now liable, they figure, for $5.8 million worth of burritos. So the separation of the spheres, the blocked exchanges have become more porous, which raises the question, what, if anything, is wrong with buying and selling these goods? Is the rampant commodification that we see troubling trend? Is it something to worry about? Or is it simply a realigning of the spheres, a renegotiation of our shared understandings? Well, one way of trying to address this question is to distinguish two objections to commodification or to extending the reach of markets. One is an argument that worries about coercion and which depends on the notions of fairness and consent. The second way of objecting to commodification is an argument not about fairness and consent and coercion, but an argument about corruption, an argument that appeals to the meaning of goods. What I would like to suggest in developing the second advantage of Michael's way is that if we consider the full range of cases in which the commodification of goods is objectionable, we will find it difficult to account for some of these cases in fairness terms alone. Difficult to account for them without drawing to some extent on the second objection, the argument that worries about the corruption or degradation of goods, treating goods in the wrong way. To illustrate this, let me just take one example, the question of how military service should be allocated. Traditionally, there are two answers to this question, by conscription or by the labor market. During the US Civil War, the Union Army was raised by an interesting hybrid of the two, and Michael discusses this unusual case in Spheres of Justice. There was a draft. Draftees were conscripted by lottery. But those who were called to serve and who didn't want to fight could hire a substitute to take their place. And people ran ads in the classified ads in newspapers for substitutes. Andrew Carnegie reportedly hired a substitute for about $300, which was less than he spent in a year on fancy cigars. Congress then eliminated the outright market and allowed people to pay $300 to the government to be exempt. Now, most people find the Civil War system morally troubling. But there are two ways of capturing what it is that's morally objectionable about the Civil War system. One way is to focus on its unfairness. It's unfair for the affluent to be able to buy their way out of military service, to hire the less fortunate to fight and die in their place. And this argument about unfairness has special force in a society whose background conditions are unfair, in a society with unequal opportunities, because in a society like that, the decision to enlist, the decision to buy into the military, may not really be voluntary. If poverty and economic disadvantage are widespread, the choice to serve may simply reflect the lack of alternatives. And so you can see how this objection is an argument about fairness, but also about coercion. Some people, the poor, may feel coerced, in effect, by the necessities of their circumstance to buy their way into military service, while the affluent can buy their way out. But there's a second objection to letting people buy their way into and out of military service. And this second objection would apply even in a society where the choice of work did not reflect deep inequalities, even in a society where the background conditions were fair, where there were an equal distribution, let's say, roughly speaking, of income and wealth, or at least on whatever theory of fairness one endorses, the background conditions are fair. Would there still, here's a way of putting the question, would there still be an objection to using the market for military service in this way? According to the second objection, there very well might be an objection, even absent the deep inequalities. What would it be? Well, it would be an objection that argues that military service shouldn't be allocated by the labor market as if it were just another job, because that's a wrong way to value the good at stake. According to the second argument, all citizens have an obligation to serve their country. Whether this obligation is best discharged through military or other national service, it's not the sort of thing on this, call it the civic view, argument from a certain conception of the good, it's not the sort of thing that people should be free to buy or sell. To turn such service into a commodity, into a job for pay, is, on this second view, to corrupt or to degrade the sense of civic virtue that properly attends it. Now, in support of this second objection, the one that appeals to the character of the good of military service as an expression of civic virtue, or national service, to speak more broadly, consider the difference between the all-volunteer army that we currently have in the United States and an army of mercenaries. Is there a morally relevant difference? Both pay soldiers to fight. Both entice people to enlist by the promise of pay and other benefits. But if the market is an appropriate way of allocating military service, provided the background conditions are fair, not coercive, then it's not clear what, if anything, is wrong with mercenaries. If military service is just another job, why should the employer discriminate in hiring on the basis of nationality? Why shouldn't the U.S. military actively recruit soldiers from among citizens of other countries who want the work and possess the relevant qualifications? These cases of ways of allocating military service suggest a general challenge to the commodification of military service, a challenge connected to the kind of good it is. If the Civil War system is objectionable on the grounds that it allows people to buy their way out of a civic obligation, then arguably the volunteer army is objectionable on similar grounds. And if military service is just another job to be allocated by the labor market, it's not so clear that there's any principled distinction between the volunteer army and a mercenary army, or the private military forces to which we are, in our actual practice, drifting. What Michael wrote about the Civil War system might also be said of a volunteer army that now enables the affluent and the influential to fight a war with other people's children. Here's what Michael wrote about the Civil War system. Quote, "It was a bad business in a republic, for it seemed to abolish the public thing and turn military service into a private transaction." All three policies, so I would suggest, all three policies, that strange Civil War system, the volunteer army we have today, and for that matter, privatized or mercenary forces, all three are objectionable not only or mainly because they're unfair, but because they abolish the public thing. They value the good in the wrong way. Our unease in each case is best articulated and justified by the argument from corruption and from the idea that shared sacrifice is a public good that money cannot buy. And so my suggestion is that insofar as there is some moral force to this second kind of objection, independent of the worry about fair background conditions, we can't reach it, we can't make sense of it, we can't articulate it, except by seeing the connection between a principle of distribution, justice on the one hand, and reasoning or arguing about the meaning of goods and how properly to value them on the other.
now we'll have a comment from Amy Gutmann, which will be followed by a brief comment from Michael, and then we'll open it up to discussion.
Well, I just want to begin by saying how welcome and at home I feel in this company of critics at the Institute of Advanced Study at Princeton, which is really infused by the Walzerian spirit, and I'll try to make my comments consistent with that spirit. I should just preface it by saying I didn't get Michael Sandel's paper in time to read it, except in the car on the way here. But I will. What I say will be an implicit commentary on both Tim and Michael's paper. Celebrating the 25th anniversary of the publication of Spheres of Justice is a bittersweet occasion. It's sweet because just about every sentence still rings relevant and ever more urgent in 08 than in 83 when it was published. But it's bittersweet because the dominations against which Michael addressed his egalitarian arguments have worsened. There is renewed urgency in our not only keeping alive these arguments, and I will argue also all allied arguments, but also in putting more of our intellectual energy into figuring out how to make every good argument more socially and politically effective. And I think that's also part of the Walzerian spirit. As Tim notes, the argument that philosophers most avidly seized upon when Spheres of Justice first appeared was the social dependence of the meaning of goods. But this relativism is far from the most relevant argument for our time. Indeed, it is probably the least relevant. There is no coherent version of an Indian caste system society today. And my divergence from Michael on the point of whether were there ever such a coherent set of social meanings that made moral sense of the untouchables living lives of desperate poverty, sickness, illiteracy, and disrespect pales. Our disagreement on that, if there is a disagreement, pales in both moral and practical significance to our convergence on the aim of egalitarianism today. To use Michael's words, to create a society free from domination. Egalitarianism should be and historically has been, as Michael emphasizes, an abolitionist politics. Egalitarians aim not at eliminating inequality per se, and therefore certainly not at eliminating all differences, but rather egalitarians target particular differences. Again, Michael's words, the differences that make for human domination, degradation, and disrespect. Egalitarians' targets are specific, but its struggles have something like the same form, abolishing not inequality per se, but domination, degradation, and disrespect that directly or indirectly emanate from certain kinds and certain degrees of inequality. To be practically effective, these struggles, Michael says, following Emerson, call for eternal vigilance. Ideally, the arguments move people to take up the cause. But pragmatically, at least, the political cause and the dominations it seeks to cast asunder must motivate and move, must energize and enlist the support of the many individuals and groups in whose name egalitarianism speaks. What kinds and what degrees of inequality should be the target today of our eternal vigilance? It is both a testament to Spheres of Justice and a sobering fact of our society and much of the world in 2008 that all the kinds of inequality at which Spheres took critical aim are with us today, and most in non-remediated forms and many in aggravated forms. Plutocracy, Michael wrote in 1983, is less frightening than totalitarianism. True enough. We would add today that plutocracy is also less frightening than state-sponsored terrorism. But Michael always speaks above all to his fellow citizens, and Spheres, therefore, spends the majority of its time making the case for complex equality in a non-totalitarian, non-terrorized setting. arguing against the tyranny of money in democratic societies, and also concluding Spheres with a section entitled Justice in the 20th Century. This is the most poignant part, which succinctly summarizes specific institutional recommendations to combat the tyranny of money, and to combat it before centuries end. It was entitled Justice in the 20th Century. Well, here we are in the 21st century, and we can ask, how has justice in our society, I should say in my society, I realize there are people here in other societies that are more fortunate in some ways, more morally fortunate than, how is justice in my society and Michael's done since 1983, judged by Michael's rather comprehensive list of antidotes to plutocracy? So here's the list, and here's my quick and dirty commentary on how we've done by Michael's standards. A strong welfare state, no, weaker, run by local and amateur officials. Well, amateur, yes. Not very local, Brownie was. A constrained market, yes, but less constrained, as Michael Sandel points out, than in 1983. An open and demystified civil service. Yes, in a sense, open and demystified for its incompetence. Independent public schools. Not according to what Michael means by independent. Educational achievement is more highly correlated with income and wealth today than it was 25 years ago. The sharing of hard work and free time, less than before. The protection of religious and familial life, by and large, yes, I would say. A system of public honoring and dishonoring, free from all considerations of rank or class, not a chance. Workers' control of companies and factories, not even close. A politics of parties, movements, meetings, and public debate, depends upon what you mean by a politics of party, movements, meetings, and public debate. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, in Michael's overarching vision, all inhabited by men and women who feel at home within them and are prepared to defend them. Very few people who are prepared to defend complex equality or any other egalitarianism that reaches basically the same conclusions as Michael's feel at home in the contemporary politics of parties, movements, meetings, and public debates. So, in sum, the domination of money outside of its proper sphere, its extramural effectiveness, as Michael succinctly puts it, has grown over the past 25 years. And its effectiveness has been accompanied by disrespect, not only for the meaning of goods such as healthcare, education, and public office, but also by increasing disrespect for and non-recognition of the people who must endure being deprived of a more equitable distribution of healthcare, education, job opportunities, and other goods. Tim ends his paper with an important, perhaps the important question raised by the rise of the new plutocracy in the United States against the backdrop of Michael's defense of complex equality. And Michael Sandel takes up this question in a way that I will also comment on here. Here's the question. If we agree that inequality in itself is not a problem, and I look to Harry Frankfurt here, who has made, I think, a quite definitive argument to my mind that inequality in itself is not a problem, should we be so concerned about the dramatically increasing inequality of income and wealth that has characterized the 25 years since Spheres was published? I think we should be, and not because inequality itself is the problem. It is a problem, as Tim suggests, that CEOs, unlike actors, partly derive their mega millions from a corrupt process of other CEOs on their comp committees voting them outside salaries, which Spheres would rightly characterize as the corruption, quote, of organizational structures and power relationships determining distributions rather than the market making the determination. But this objection, while I think valid, proves too little. since an increasing number of the Forbes 1,100 billionaires are not CEOs who depend on compensation committees for their fortunes, but hedge fund managers who make their fortunes running other people's money and being taxed at far lower capital gains rates rather than at far higher regular income tax rates, even though they're only risking other people's money, not their own, and they're making billions by doing so. I think that won't get at it either, and I think we need to go back to the idea with which Michael began, that egalitarianism is an abolitionist doctrine. And it's not the abolition of an inequality, but of domination, and I would add, of disrespect for and among persons. The domination and disrespect that attaches to poverty, to deprivation of health care, to inadequate education, to physical insecurity, and the lack of fair, let alone equal opportunity to develop and use one's talents for self-recognition, self-realization, and social recognition. We need then to recognize just what has happened over the past 25 years in our society, an exaggeration of what has happened internationally. Not only have the number of billionaires ballooned, there were 154 new ones last year alone, and 178 new ones the year before. Being a university president and a part-time, some people think full-time, but it's actually, in my case, very part-time, full fundraiser, I know the number of billionaires who have Penn degrees very well, and I expect them all to be very generous. But that is separate from some of what I'm about to say, not all. The proportion and number of Americans who are uninsured for health care has skyrocketed over the last 25 years from 31 million to 48 million. Several million more people live in poverty today in this country alone than did in 1983. Educational attainment has risen in the US since 1983, but the rise among young people has been almost non-existent and far slower than in countries as diverse as Canada, Ireland, Japan, Korea, New Zealand, Norway, and Spain. And the correlation of higher income, higher education with family income has risen dramatically over the past 25 years, with the ballooning of so-called merit aid to public as well as private universities, which goes overwhelmingly to the children of the affluent and is a direct trade-off with need-based financial aid, such that it's no longer credible to claim that higher education in the United States is generally being distributed more than it was 25 years ago on the basis of native talent rather than family income and family privilege. The more affluent any society becomes, the less excuse it has for these dominations, these corruptions, these forms of disrespect that these trends display. In a society still abounding in preventable infant mortality, in treatable illness, in physical insecurity, in the inadequacy of elementary and secondary education, and the unaffordability of high-quality higher education to middle-income as well as low-income families, plutocracy is far, far more troubling than the same degree of income and wealth inequalities would be in a society where everyone had effective access to a high level of health care, physical security, education, job opportunities, disposable income, and cultural goods. Why is plutocracy so troubling? For all the reasons that Michael Walzer gave in Spheres of Justice and Tim and Michael Sandel gave us today, plus some. It is unfair as well as corrupt for the state to tax ordinary people's incomes at over twice the rate it taxes hedge fund managers. Talk about Katrina. Talk about the ability of government to basically lie to the public. Talk about the ability of the mega wealthy to buy their children into public office. Talk about the need for middle income Americans to go to India, as the New York Times reported yesterday, to get high-level health care using a set of health care services that are not available to millions and millions of Indians. Unfair and corrupt. Unfair and corrupt. One does not need to choose between these arguments in public. Both can be powerful depending on the sensibilities of the person or group one is addressing. Perhaps one is the right argument, but perhaps not. Mathematicians prefer the more elegant of proofs, but they, even they, do not deny the existence of multiple proofs of the same theorem. Why are moral and political philosophers so much surer that liberalism or communitarianism, Walzerianism or Rawlsianism is the right way to get to what they agree are the same, basically same ends, which is to find some effective ways of arguing against what most decent thinking people can agree is a society and a world of increasing injustice. So I end with a plea in the Walzerian spirit to moral and political philosophers who agree that it is unjust for 48 million members of an affluent society not to be insured, for 36 million to be living below the poverty line, and for many millions more to be deprived around the world. The plea is for us to spend a little less time defending the single right reasons or grounds, plenty of time arguing against arguments that deny the injustice of the things that I've just mentioned, and a little, maybe a lot more time trying to determine intellectually, because we are intellectuals, and I don't expect us all to go out manning the barricades, but a little more time, a lot more time, trying to determine intellectually what arguments among the many that point in the same direction will work well in the many public and private contexts they will need to work well in and to resonate with the many people they will need to resonate with in order to make more progress in the next 25 years of the 21st century than we managed to make in the 25 years since Spears of Justice appeared. I would like to work with the largest company of critics possible across theoretically sectarian lines to make this country, my country, Michael's country, and our world far, far freer from domination, corruption, injustice, and unfairness. Then and only then would most decent thinking people have reason to feel truly at home, not only with their families and friends and in places like this with comrades in philosophy, but also in a world that is at least moving in a direction in which we can be proud, rather than, as I am today, rather ashamed and aghast at my society's direction and the world's. Thanks.
Michael, it's your turn. You can have my seat if you like.
Well, I have been asked to comment at the end of each of these panels for a few minutes just to make sure that I'm paying attention. and especially to any critical remarks. And I want to say that I'm enormously grateful for all of these papers. They are very serious, as you will discover if you stay for the next 3 days. And they are written on the assumption, on the wonderfully flattering assumption, that I can still learn from my errors. So I will try to say something about these two papers very briefly, but first I do want to thank Amy for reminding us that political theory is a political project. And we do have to attend to its political effectiveness. And although I am now going to engage in some of the academic arguments that that she suggested we should put aside, I do recognize the importance of politics, and I do feel a great distance between a great distance from political theorists who are not interested in politics, and I'm afraid in the academic world there are quite a few people like that. Michael Sandel reminds us that it is possible to reason about social goods, and that's a very important statement, and it's one that he then illustrates by reasoning about the way we distribute the burdens of military service in the United States. And he provides, I think, an exemplary way of thinking through that question of who serves when not everyone serves. And Tim Scanlon, who comes at these questions from a very different direction, in addressing the question of fair equality of opportunity, reasons through in a very similar fashion. Reasons through the questions of what the nature of our obligation is to provide every child with the same opportunities to fulfill all his or her talents. And it may be the case, as he suggested, that an account of fairness does better than an account of social meanings in defending what is actually a quite radical idea of substantive equality of opportunity, what Rawls calls fair equality of opportunity. I want to suggest just one more way of thinking about that issue, or maybe two more ways of thinking about them, that work from my own approach through social meanings. Imagine a child who's very good at cutting, and we want to give him or her every possible opportunity to grow up to be a great surgeon at a major hospital in a big city in our country. Every child who has this talent for cutting, we want to give him the same opportunity. And Tim worries that theory of the social meaning of the office of a surgeon isn't going to provide that, isn't going to lead us to that fairness. But I suggest that there's another way of thinking about it, and that is thinking about it from the angle of the people who need to be cut. And to think of the office of the surgeon as we think about any office, an engineer, a civil servant, his role is to help other people. And from the point of view of someone who needs to be cut, the need, the desire, the wish to be cut by the best cutter is, I think, a very powerful and legitimate wish, and a very strong reason. Once we understand what the office of a surgeon is and what role the surgeon plays in our lives, we will want to make sure that the people who are best at cutting get to be the surgeons who cut us. And And that does seem to me to be an argument, perhaps not strong enough for full substantive equality of opportunity, but then we aren't in favor of full substantive equality of opportunity. In fact, as I think Rawls points out, because that would require us to take every child out of his or her family and give them exactly the same upbringing. And we are not prepared to do that because of the social meaning of family life in our society, because of the values we attach to parent-child relationships and so on. I probably, if you won't have any time if I talk any longer, so I think I'm going to stop, and as I've been told to stop, and I will be back at the end of the next session.
We're now ready for questions. Is Yitzhak, is there a microphone that we can circulate? Okay, I think we can begin anyway. Most of you are can speak loudly enough to begin with. George Cato. Can you stand up, though?
Shared sacrifice in connection with fighting a war as an alternative to fighting the war with other people's children. That seems to me a good, a public good. From a number of points of view. One of them would be the point of view of fairness. Another would be the point of view of civic formation and sharing a common life. And connected with that would be the good of motivating the deliberation about whether to go to war in the right way, which is to say, democratically, where not only the number of votes reflected the democracy, but also the consequences of the vote to go to war would have some democratic weight. That's why it seems to me, in connection with military service and the decision whether to go to war, that the war would be fought in a way that would require shared sacrifice is important for is an important civic and democratic good. Could I just say one thing about cutting? As this is just having undergone surgery myself, it never occurred to me, Michael, that I wanted the best cutter. I was thinking more in terms of the best. The person best at repairing and stitching, not so much cutting.
Maybe this has something to do with whose grandparents were in the garment trades. Other questions? Yes.
Torn between asking about conscription and about immigration, but since George got us going on conscription.
Can you stand up and
yes.
Also hold the microphone closer? Thanks.
Since George got us going on conscription, I'll keep going. Michael, your paper about the parts of your paper about the meaning of military service, which are detached from any of Michael Walzer's sense that meanings can change from time to time and from place to place, and therefore you're willing to impute to 2008 United States the social meaning of military service that was the social meaning in Sparta seems deeply problematic to me in a way that I think is simpatico with the way it does to George. We now think the social meaning of lives is that partly we have our own lives. We are not wholly the property of the state. Sacrifice in wartime isn't ever shared fully. The burden of fighting and dying falls on those who are young able-bodied men at the time that there happens to be a war.
I think women now too, right?
Though outside Israel, conscription of women during wartime doesn't seem to be, even when Charles Rangel proposed reintroducing conscription, conscripting women wasn't on his agenda. But then young able-bodied persons at the time that there happens to be a war, that's generationally unequal. And part of what is at stake in the choice between the logic of market and the logic of conscription for military service is what shall be told to those people who are the segment of a society being asked to fight, kill, and die, that they are owed some compensation by the rest of society, some compensation that they might think is commensurate with what they are being asked to give up, or that should they not wish to do so, they will go to jail. If there is a social meaning to individual lives in the modern world and in modern liberal societies that is not the Spartan social meaning, then something is also owed to that part of society that's being asked to kill and die. And the refusal to pay them market wages that would induce them to enlist voluntarily is a refusal on the part of the rest of society that's asking them to volunteer to ante up out of their own wallets for the benefit of those who are being asked to ante up out of blood.
Well, I'm partly worried about not only how markets distribute, but also how markets teach as they distribute. And to go to the, before coming back to the military case, it seems to me the worst thing about having a market in organs, kidneys, corneas, is that type of thing, is that it would teach people, get people into the habit of thinking of their bodies as their private property to dispose of as they please. And that that teaching would be corrupting of proper ways of regarding the body that carry consequences for other privatizing practices. And in the case of military service, I think that we've been having a lot of this discussion has been on the welfare state and public provision. But one of the ways, I think there's a connection between the ability of a society to muster the solidarity necessary for a stronger, deeper welfare state, public provision, a taking of common responsibility for health, education, welfare of all citizens. I think there's a connection between that underlying sense of a shared common life and mutual responsibility and a sharing of burdens and risks and dangers associated with fighting wars. I think it's not an accident that in the United States, one of the greatest impetuses to a powerful part of the American welfare state, flawed though it is, was the GI Bill after World War II, where there was an outpouring of public support and with a moral foundation for the taking of public responsibility for the education of returning veterans. And if you generalize that idea that there is it wouldn't necessarily need to be tied to military service, but if there were a practice of universal national service expected of all citizens, that would strengthen the case morally and politically. This is back to the internal connection between distributive justice and social solidarity. Morally and politically, a system of universal national service would strengthen the case for a deeper, stronger scheme of public provision in the welfare state.
Tim Scanlon, you wanted to say something.
I wanted to say something about cutting too, but I'll let that go and just continue this for the moment. I'm not here to be a partisan of fairness versus social meanings. I think both are, as I hope was clear from my paper, both are relevant, but I was struck by Michael's observation that in politics, appeals to fairness seem weaker than appeals to particular goods. And in the case, for example, of healthcare, this seemed to be right. That is, although there's opposition to to the idea of move toward universal health care. Nonetheless, it's got a lot more pull than the idea that, let's say, the tax system is fundamentally unfair or that the distribution of income is fundamentally unfair. But in the case of military service, I wondered whether the opposite was true. That is, it seems to me the opposition to the draft, I'm sorry, the opposition to the being able to buy your way out of the draft, or opposition to volunteer army on the ground that it unfairly locates the burdens on one part of society, might seem to me maybe politically stronger than the, I don't want to say romantic, but anyway, appeal of the idea of the meaning of national service. Not that that doesn't have appeal, but that in this last thing, it seems to me that its appeal depends very much on how one understands the function of the military in the particular war that's in question. When the homeland is threatened and is being defended, then the idea that we all have an obligation to do something to contribute to the common defense, and that's an obligation that we all have, and maybe only the young and strong can do the actual fighting, but we all have to do something, seems quite plausible and strong. Where the army is an instrument used for one or another kind of foreign adventure, I'm not certain why there's an obligation there that's stronger than the obligation, let's say, to be a coal miner or some other hazardous profession. So it seems to me that we shouldn't just talk about the military. It very much depends upon what kind of enterprise we're talking about.
On national service more generally, I agree the military shouldn't be the sole carrier of it, but since we're talking about political resonance, the line in Obama's standard stump speech that strikes the deepest chord and gets the biggest applause time after time after time is when he couples two things. When he says he is going to provide all students who are qualified with public support for higher education, payment of tuition, and so on, so that no one is deprived of higher education. But in return, that he would tie that to some kind of requirement of national service. And the link of these two ideas, public provision and national service, not military necessarily, invariably strikes the deepest chord and brings the most powerful response. And I think for reasons connected to the things that we've been discussing.
Yes, Helen.
Hi, Nitzenbaum. I have a question, I don't know, a comment that connects all of the speaker's points. And this is, I have a problem with hypotheticals like Peakville, which I understand to be a society in which you have a few very, very well off, and then the rest of relatively affluent. And that is that in a way it seems impossible to have even that as a hypothetical if you have sufficient numbers of the very rich and you have, as Michael Sandel suggests, the commodification of increasing numbers of even basic goods. And, you know, if Amy Gutmann is correct in saying we have more and more billionaires, then what happens is that those basic goods, which are then open to the marketplace, become luxuries. Only the rich will be able to be cut by the best cutters. So anyway, I question whether you can work with that kind of hypothetical given these other phenomena.
I don't think we disagree. I give this abstract description of Peakville and Valleyland that I got from this book and say, look, just given that abstract description, you can't tell anything about what the objection is. If there's an objection on grounds of inequality, it has to have to do with what would be the consequences of this in the given situation. And so I speculated on a couple of ways in which it might have consequences, and you've mentioned another. So I don't think there's a disagreement between us on this point. Okay. I don't want to deny that. I just want to say, in order to decide what's wrong, you have to look at what the consequences of this distribution would be. It's not just the bare distribution itself that matters. And so we're on the same page about that.
Ian Shapiro. You could probably start talking without the microphone.
He likes the suspense.
This is actually in different ways for all three, both the paper givers and for Amy. I'd like to invite them all to say a little bit more about the role of the idea of solidarity in their reasoning. It seems to me that we've sort of under-attended to this idea, which, as Michael's paper points out, is central to Michael Walzer's thinking about justice. It seemed to me that Michael Sandel was saying that that absent a basis in social solidarity, appeals to justice are not going to work. I think that this is also true of fairness arguments, that if you can think that something's very unfair, but just say, well, isn't it too bad that person has to have put up with some unfair consequence, but unless you feel some solidarity with that person, you're not going to necessarily feel obliged to do anything to remedy that unfairness. And Tim Scanlon was saying we should be putting other arguments on the table about inequality. It seems to me that one of the arguments for limiting relative inequalities is there erosion of the possibility of solidarity. If you talk about the massive incomes of very wealthy people, part of the consequence of that is it creates differential exit costs. We can buy our way out. I heard a millionaire the other day opining that the best hospital in the UK for medical care is Terminal 4 at Heathrow, so that if you have massive relative inequalities, it has the independent effect, in addition to everything else, of eroding the possibility of social solidarity, which in turn I think limits the political effectiveness of arguments about injustice. So I just put that out there for any or all of the speakers.
Amy.
So one of the arguments in Michael's book, which I expanded upon in Democratic Education against voucher systems in education, is precisely this, that it's a much more extensive example than the number of billionaires, but it basically has the same basic argument that Ian is pointing to, and it's yet another argument in what I think is an arsenal of arguments about what's terribly wrong with the direction that our society, this society and the world, largely but not entirely because of the direction of the society is taken, which is if you privatize education for parents, for their children, and you give parents a voucher, you take away any solidarity among communities that would tie in, and you can use the language of solidarity or you can use the language of economic incentives on this, but it amounts to the same thing. You're undermining the solidarity that will help generate public goods. So it's become heightened when you look at billionaires and mega millionaires, because you don't have to be a billionaire to be able to afford to live in a gated community, to have concierge service with doctors, to send your children to very expensive private schools, many of which give excellent education, and so on and so forth. So all of that, I think, is right, Ian. But I think we've got to be careful not to overuse the solidarity argument, because use it in a refined way that's consistent with justice. Because you can argue, and this is a way I think none of us would want to argue, but it's out there. The argument is out there, we should close this country's borders and indeed deport a lot of people who aren't part of the community that people naturally feel solidarity to, because that will make the United States more able to be a robust welfare state. Now, I'm not even sure empirically that that's true, but let's just grant that empirically it's easier for a country like Sweden. I mean, I think it is true that it's empirically easier for a country like Sweden to be a welfare state than it is for a country as diverse as the US. But solidarity, the claims of solidarity have to be used in a way that are morally bounded. That's the only thing I would just put as a caveat here. The same way that these arguments about sacrifice in wartime, it may be a great way of getting higher education funded to draft people to go to war. And even to an unjust war, it might be a great way of doing it. But it wouldn't be great in the sense of effective. It would not be a morally great way of doing it.
I agree with Ian that the undermining of social solidarity is another reason for worrying about inequality. I don't know what most people out there in the country are thinking or feeling about inequality, whether they're resenting the fact that multimillionaires can get their slicing done by the very best surgeons and so on. But it's striking that, as we all know, in the political discourse, in what you see on television and read in the newspapers, the main lack of solidarity out there is between ordinary people and elites. And elites aren't those very rich people. So there's some other kind of lack of solidarity, some sense of mistrust and resentment that's directed not against the people who are enjoying the most, but somewhere else. And I don't know why that is. Maybe that doesn't actually reflect what people are really thinking, but only what's been somehow manufactured. But it seems if we're looking for expressions of the absence of solidarity in the political discourse, that's one that seems to pop up a lot and is a somewhat mystifying thing.
It's an important question, and we shouldn't skate over it too quickly in the spirit of kind of commonality here. So I wonder if I could draw a distinction, Tim, and then see whether you agree or disagree with this account of the relation between solidarity on the one hand and distributive justice on the other. As Ian put it, one issue is that in the absence of solidarity, appeals to fairness are not going to work. That's a question of political effectiveness, and I certainly agree with that. Michael's thesis in Spheres of Justice involves a stronger claim. It includes that one, but as I understand it, it includes a stronger claim, which is that what justice requires, what the right distributive principles are, depend in part on the degree and kind of social solidarity that characterizes the political community in question. So I take that to be the more demanding claim. I have some sympathy with that claim, but I would like to put to Tim the question, do you accept the second way of connecting justice and solidarity as well as the first?
That's an excellent question, and I have to say I do have my doubts about that. I think if we think of a society in which everyone feels the sense of identification with the others and are comfortably at home, and that seems like a very great good. But of course, a lot of people could feel that for no good reason. They might be manipulated into feeling that. So the underlying question is, when are feelings of solidarity justified? It's not just when people are carried away by national identity or something else, but when they're getting a fair shake. So I have to say that if what's valuable isn't just solidarity, but the right kind of solidarity for the right reasons, you might say, and that may depend on a prior question of what people are entitled to.
Okay, good.
The term solidarity is no more transparent than the term equality or egalitarianism and so on. So. I wrote a book on identity. It turns out there are lots of psychological experiments that I read about before I wrote this book, which were really quite eye-opening to me, because we think about identifying with other people depending, and this is empirically dependent, depending on our what's happening, the larger politics of our society. So we think about racial identification and the lack thereof, and so on. It turns out when you do experiments with people, the smallest things lead people to identify with one another. So there's an experiment in which women are sitting at a cafe and a very beautiful woman is brought in and introduced to them, and their self-esteem goes down as a consequence when they see a beautiful model. If they're told, while they're introduced to this person, that they share the same birthday, their self-esteem goes up because they identify with the woman. Now, it turned out those experiments were done decades ago and they were only done with women. I think it would work with men as well. But little things, I mean, I'm left-handed and I notice when other people are left-handed and I immediately have a bond with them because of that. So if we're talking, it's gotta be very important. There are ways of, you can call it manipulating, but there are also ways of creating greater solidarity among human beings because of all the things human beings share in common. And so I just think it's really important for us creatively and society to think institutionally about creative ways of creating the kinds of solidarities for instrumental moral reasons, and not to think that the pre-existing, and this is an answer to Michael Sandel's and in some ways Michael Walzer's argument in Spheres of Justice, that the pre-existing conscious solidarities in a society determine justice when there aren't a set of pre-existing solidarities independent of human action. Human action, simple things like telling people that they share the same X, can't change the view about solidarity. I was raised to identify with all people because of the Seders, and you know, this was a Reform Jewish, 12 years of Hebrew school, that we all, every human being in the world is part of a group that had to leave Egypt at some point. We were all slaves in the land of Egypt. Where the we was not just Jews, but all groups had this. And Michael's written a book on this, Exodus and Revolution. That book really was the primer, even though it was written after my Jewish education, that could have been the primer for my Jewish education. I think a lot of people and a lot of societies could take a lesson from the way Reform Jews read the Exodus from Egypt, and we'd have more solidarity to base better justice on.
I guess I just would add a question to that, which is, if solidarity is a sort of socially created meaning, isn't fairness, and then the question of the sort of opposition that people keep talking about between fairness and social meaning, seems to me to be called into question.
Well, Joan, that's my point, is that it is a it's just a hopeless debate. And it's a debate that's been going. I could have been teletransported from the first time I heard this debate between liberals and communitarians to now. It's just a false.
But isn't that part of the reason that on both sides there's social meaning? I mean, fairness is a socially validated meaning, just as whatever the other social meanings
so
are.
So Michael's, we all agree, I think, and Tim explicitly puts this in his paper, we all agree that the particular meaning of what's fair depends on a context.
Right.
So that changes over time and with society. There's some things that may never be fair. It may never be fair to mutilate, to torture people. Mm-hmm. What actually constitutes torture is, you know, there are going to be gray areas which do change over time.
All right, I have a list actually of people whose hands have been up. Harry Frankfurt was first, yeah.
When instances were cited by a couple of the speakers of enormous salaries earned or given to CEOs and the increase the number of billionaires. I was kind of shocked, and I asked myself, what is it about this that bothers me so much? And it is true that it's fairness and it's equality and considerations of solidarity and so forth, but there's something else about it as well. To me, a billionaire in our society is something like a professional bodybuilder who develops grotesque muscles that are of no use to anybody, certainly of no use to himself, and that are in fact a distortion of human development. Why don't we regard billionaires with derision and ridicule? They're leading silly lives. And what's missing from the discussion, and what's missing, I think, from a great deal of liberal theory is our conception, or our, not, I shouldn't say our, a conception of what constitutes a good human life. It seems to me that in all the discussions of equality and fairness and solidarity, however valuable they may be, and I think they are very valuable, I don't mean to diminish the importance of these things, what's missing to me at any rate is, well, as I said a moment ago, what constitutes a good human life and what constitutes a bad human life? What is a distortion of human life? What is it that corresponds in human life to the grotesque bodybuilding, which on steroids or even without steroids results in a distorted and meaningless, excessively developed muscular structure? It seems to me that we have that sort of thing, that sort of phenomena in our society outside of the realm of bodybuilding, and plutocracy is one great instance of it. And it seems to me we ought to object to plutocracy in addition to objecting to it on grounds of fairness and equality and solidarity. We ought to object to it because it's a stupid way to live, to accumulate large amounts of money that are of no use to you, that are far beyond what anybody can reasonably use for comfort or even for extravagant luxury. And unless the billionaire simply gives the money away, which might be a valuable contribution, to me it's ugly, it's grotesque, it's bizarre, and we ought to reject it for reasons of that kind, as well as for the kind of political considerations that have been widely discussed here this morning.
I think you have very eager respondents here. Let's start with they can't even decide who should go
first. I don't disagree, Harry, but following in your footsteps or in your shadow, whatever, I was trying to think about when is inequality objectionable? Now, yeah. It's one thing to say, as you would say, the inequality is objectionable. What we should be worrying about is the plight of the people down below. And to want to yeah. save people from poverty isn't to worry about inequality. So now you're saying the flip side of that. we should be saving the rich from themselves. both of these can be right, but they leave... I wasn't disagreeing with them, but only focusing my attention on the other question, which you've raised, which are, is the difference between them and the rest of us at all something we should worry about, and if so, why? I'll turn the rest over to Michael.
Well, I think Harry is pushing us in a good direction. Going back to Tim's question that he posed, why is... Is this vast inequality of CEOs objectionable for reasons of inequality only or for their effects? Tim says for the effects. And I want to agree with that, but to specify the effects that make it objectionable. And those effects are that, at least in societies like ours, the effect of this inequality is that where money can buy a lot of things, is that the affluent buy their way out of public things and common things, whether it's public schools or public police protection, into gated communities, that increasingly the rich lead lives separate from the rest, and that this is a bad effect. And here we come to Harry's contribution to this. It's a bad effect not only because it leaves public facilities to the poor and they become shoddy and badly supported, though that's part of it. If if everybody doesn't ride the public transportation or the subway, it's going to be pretty bad. Likewise, the public schools and so on. That's one part of the effect. But the other part of effect is that there is a corruption or a degradation of the civic infrastructure of a common life. And that's bad for the common life, not only for those who are left with shoddy public services, but also for those who secede, the affluent. And they live worse lives because they have, this is, so I think you're, it's not just a matter of social solidarity in the sense of feeling certain things subjectively. They live worse lives because lacking an engagement with common things and public things and bumping up against men and women from different walks of life and different backgrounds, those who secede, come to lead lives that are impoverished in ways that a more direct engagement with common things and public things would improve. So lying behind my concern about the basis of social solidarity in a common life is not just is not a communitarian idea, but a perfectionist idea more like yours that worries about what constitutes a good human life and that worries about the corruption and the loss to the lives of those who secede, not just because they're silly, but because they lack the kind of engagement with a wider society that a good life requires. So that, I think there's a connection between the worry about solidarity, but it's not a communitarian worry only or mainly. It's a perfectionist worry. It's a worry about what lives are good lives to lead.
Really brief.
I just want to say one further thing, Harry. Put in relation to Michael Walzer's view, your point is that the social meaning of great wealth that prevails in the United States is mistaken and corrupt and ought to be gotten rid of. So in making the point, you're agreeing in part with Michael and dissenting in part, agreeing that social meanings are important, but taking them as important as the objects of criticism rather than as the basis of standards from which all criticism has to start. We're stepping outside, you're suggesting us we should step outside this mindset which prevails and ask a question about it.
So, in heated agreement with Harry, but unlike bodybuilders, a lot of billionaires don't have to exercise any muscles to get richer. And so there's nothing that many of them inherit their wealth, others run other people's money in ways that aren't very taxing, actually. So it would be great if, aside from the political issues, there were to develop a more of a critique of what it means to live a life that is geared mainly towards making, you know, more and more at the very high level of money. However, there are billionaires like Bill Gates, they're a minority, but there are billionaires like Bill Gates and Warren Buffett who do a lot with their billions in a context which sadly, the context that I was talking about, sadly governments and other institutions aren't doing what they are set up ostensibly for doing. Yes, I just want to add to what Harry said that it, apart from everything we've said here, it would be really good for more philosophers to talk about the unseemliness, the grotesqueness of the simple phenomena that we've experienced, which is hugely increased pursuit of money at levels that were here, you know, before this era, heard of only at the turn of the 20th, you know, the 19th to 20th century.
In the interest of time and of a certain kind of democracy, I'm going to call on a number of people to pose their questions, and then
let the panelists selectively answer them when we come to the end. So I have Brian as the next person.
Jet lag has further eroded my anyway diminished capacity to address these issues in the abstract. So I'll just cite an example and from which I and Danny to an degree have been involved in and ask your reaction, if you will. Donor cards for donation of organs after death, not during life. Well, in Israel we have a problem that there's a lesser willingness to sign those cards, and there was an initiative about 2 years ago to say, well, let's give people extra points in the allocation, you know, in line for getting an organ if you need it, if you have a donor card. And then we got into an interesting philosophical argument between two bands of philosophers in the advisory committee. Asa Kasher said that would be terrible. And he quoted a kind of spheres of justice argument. He said, health resources should be distributed only on the basis of health need. So if you need the organ, if you need it more, if you need it urgently, that should count. And otherwise, just saying, you know, whether you're a good citizen in that you signed the donor card, or he said, maybe you served in the army or did some other good public service, should not be relevant for that distribution. And against that, I argued insistently that it was a question of solidarity, that people were trying to be free riders and maybe get organs without being themselves willing to be donors, even in death, and that that was enabling that to go on unchallenged without this kind of incentive system was not conducive to the requisite solidarity. I'm happy to say that my view and Danny's prevailed and the law was passed with that point system. But it's still a nagging question in terms of was Asa right that this was wrong, or was I right that this was a question of how do you build solidarity, not in the so-called social psychology sense that Amy was talking about, but in terms of, you know, getting people to really, it's not money, but to put their organs where their hopes lie.
There was a hand way in the back, yeah.
Yes. You suggested that many people resonate with, or fail to resonate with, the idea of fairness. And I'm wondering if what you're saying, in other words, is that very often our discussions of justice are absent of moral content. That is to say, we extract from justice or from the idea of fairness moral content, so that fairness ends up being equated with personal interest, self-interest, or interest groups, rather than abiding shared human moral intuitions that are true for all people at all times in all places. A question.
Louis Levitt, did you have your hand up?
Yeah, I'm increasingly persuaded.
I'm sorry,
Stephen.
To use multiple criteria, multiple principles, because it seems increasingly obvious that each of the principles that we use have some serious problems. So, for one, it seems that some of the to me at least, that the examples of Peakville and Valleyville are inadequate, because we can have many different kinds of societies with comparable Gini indices, and yet have very different kinds of internal equalities. For instance, Peakville and Valleyville has very sharp gradients, but we can think of other societies that have smoother gradients at various places and have very different mechanisms of envy and lack of solidarity within that might actually injure some of these principles. Also, there seem to be some serious problems with the issue of solidarity. We've already heard some that there could be mischief. The issue of privatization and being worried about individuals' control of their own body and perhaps giving more weight to the community's voice and how you use the body might be used in mischievous arguments against women's control of their own bodies. I think that's a dangerous argument. So it seems to me that we must use a sort of matrix of multiple arguments. Indeed, Michael's argument about surgeons, I think, doesn't completely follow through, because we might think in terms of society's interest that we need a certain number of surgeons which could adequately, perhaps more than adequately, be satisfied from the children of plutocrats. Also, plutocrats probably do give us some social goods, indeed even for solidarity. They give us hopes, they give us dreams. And so I think that, to some people. And indeed, the principle of rejecting that something worth doing isn't worth overdoing should be considered very carefully by people who spend all their time on thinking about what social goods are.
I have two more people. There was the woman sitting next to Ian, and then Stephen Lukes, and then we'll see what time is left can be said. Okay, so Stephen then.
I've got a question for Amy. I thought Tim asked a great question, which you've been very interestingly responding to in various ways, namely what's wrong with plutocracy. But Amy said that decent thinking people basically agree about the injustice of plutocracy. I wonder if that's true. I actually think it's probably not true. And it relates, I mean, in this way, I think you're being a true Walzerian, true to the project of spheres of justice. namely, the project of articulating what he calls common understandings. And I wonder, I mean, is this really a common understanding that is there somehow, if not on the surface, deeply buried and there to be brought out and built upon? I wonder. That's all.
Thank you. Okay, we have a very little bit of time left in which I'll give each of you a couple of minutes to sum up or answer what you can. You want to start, Tim?
On these questions, I'm with you, Noam. I think that the alternative position was kind of one-eyed and fetishistic or something. But I also want to go back to what Michael said about cutting. It seems to me that argument for fair equality of opportunity is what I called a top-down argument from the claims of efficiency of the organization as a whole, extending not simply to the point of selection, but also to making the pool of candidates as good as possible. And it's driven very strongly in that case by the fact that each of us cares very, 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 very much about how good the cutting is. So because the goal of efficiency is so important, marginal deltas or epsilons in efficiency seem very important, and so it's worth paying the cost of searching them out. So that fit the model that I was describing. My worry was that when you get away from surgery to other things, how strong the efficiency argument is for searching out the best, you know, improving public higher education, lower education, preschool training for the children of the poor, and so on. How strong the case is for doing that may not be strong enough, right? And so it would vary. But for surgeons, I'm with you.
Michael. On the relation of solidarity to justice, if solidarity is understood as a purely subjective psychological identification, then I would say it's no basis for justice. Just what people happen purely psychologically to identify with isn't a sufficient reason for basing justice on that solidarity. The solidarity that I do think is internally connected to justice and distributive principles requires that there be some critical assessment of an argument about the goods that constitute the social practices or the shared understandings. That's why I think that tying justice to social practices, social goods, social solidarities only avoids relativism if it's possible critically to evaluate and assess and argue about the goods that are embodied in the common identifications, common purposes, social practices. That would be point number one. Point number two, there is still a philosophical question whether it's possible to define and to justify principles of fairness or of justice without taking up arguments about the meanings of goods or the adequacy of this or that understanding goods. That's the philosophical argument. And then there's the related political argument. Why don't arguments, or is it the case, as I think it is, that arguments about fairness don't resonate politically? But I think the reason they don't is connected to not just a contingent political fact, but to a mistaken philosophical way of arriving at those principles, not connected to a conception of good. Can I say just one more thing about the politics of all of this and the secession of the affluent from common spaces and institutions and why that's bad? I think that the most politically effective way of addressing inequality in the United States for the moment is to forget about fairness, Tim, and to argue about the erosion, the hollowing out of public spaces and shared common citizenship. That will help those, and part of that argument can be about the injustice done to those who were left to suffer shoddy public provision. But I have a hunch that the people who have seceded, the affluent and the influential, with part of themselves don't really like the condition that they have found themselves in, don't see that as the best way of life, a life, so to speak, of gated communities and private security and so on. And that there is room for a moral and political argument that would address that. Not to tell them your lives are silly, Harry, but to say your lives, our lives, would be that much richer if we were to create a common life that would enable the healthcare system and the school system and the transportation system and the public libraries and the health facilities to be good enough so that rich and poor alike would want to gather in those places.
Amy.
It is a fact that not one of the candidates who are running for public office, the highest public office in the United States, if you still consider the presidency of the United States the highest public office in the United States after what's been done to it, not one of them is willing to argue that they're going to increase taxes on other than the people who earn over $200,000 a year. I think the way to make that argument effective will take a lot of political courage, join an argument that Daniel Patrick Moynihan famously made when welfare reform was going to cut off aid to welfare mothers if they had, if they didn't get, there weren't jobs for them and they had another child, when he said, yes, it's telling infants to shape up or starve. That's an argument for solidarity and unfairness, to say you are heartless and indecent if you can't identify with an infant who doesn't have enough to eat. So let me just answer Stephen Luke's question, which was addressed to me. When I wrote and said, I think most decent thinking people would object to plutocracy, I actually underlined it and said, is this empirically true? Now, one can define decency and thinking in a way that it has to be true, but I don't, I take your point, and I think it was the point I made earlier, and it is a point about bringing new social meanings to light, which is you have to show a lot of decent people who are willing to think what is wrong with plutocracy, and you can't do it largely by words like solidarity, unfairness, corruption, and so on. You have to start, and I'm going to end by this plea, you have to start by telling them some facts about how people are living, both at the top and at the bottom, and increasingly in the middle in our world, what their lives are like, and what you can and can't do with billions of dollars, and what you can and can't do when you don't have health care and so on, and appeal. Then you can launch into our theoretical arguments. It is remarkable how few decent thinking people know anything about the inequality in our society, the fact that the US has a Gini coefficient that's closer to Zimbabwe's than to Canada's. And that in itself isn't going to tell people anything, because, but then, how many people are living what kinds of lives? And that's got to be tied to doing moral and political philosophy, and that, I think, is why Spheres of Justice is such a rich book, because it combines real thick description of what the world and our society and history is like with moral and political arguments. So I would, if this is the end, we all here join in solidarity in arguments of fairness and against injustice, in thanking Michael for writing this book, which is really quite a treat rereading 25 years later.
But before we do that,
sorry.
I just would like to call this session to an end. We're only 7 minutes late, Yitzhak, so this is a good precedent, I think, for the rest of the conference, not only in its discipline, but in the richness of the conversation that's been begun. I think conferences like this are never meant to be sewed up, just sliced and cut, or the issues are meant to be sliced and cut. And I'd just like to say that it's shown, I think, once again, that Michael has launched a set of conversations that, retired or not, he has to keep participating in, because they're nowhere near finished. Thank you, and thank you all very much. Yitzhak, are there instructions about lunch?
Yep.
Just tell me.